This afternoon, we're switching our focus a little bit from a theological and historical background of the religious freedom documents to turf that's more comfortable for me anyway, the international arena. And I'm very happy to introduce our three panels for this afternoon's presentation on religious freedom, the church, and international law. You know, our first panelist is Father John Langan, who is from Georgetown, I'm proud to say, and is the Cardinal Bernardine Chair in Catholic Social Thought in the Department of Philosophy here at Georgetown University. And next to him is Daniel Philpott, who's Associate Professor in the Department of Political Science and the Kroc Institute for Peace Studies at Notre Dame, and who is the author of a new book we heard mentioned this morning that will be discussed in a panel tomorrow, Just and Unjust Peace. And then at the end of the panel here, Bob Destro, who is a professor at Catholic University, a professor of law and the director and founder of the interdisciplinary program in law and religion there, and has many other accomplishments in this area to his credit. So as we switch, you know, our focus a little bit to religious freedom, international law, I know some of the international law that matters on this subject certainly has to be the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. And it's a very poignant moment to be having this panel, given the events of the last 48 hours. But I think we can all in our minds immediately list an array of topics to which our panelists might be speaking. And we are having, again, three orienting questions for the panel. And each will be talking about 8 to 10 minutes, the way we did this morning in the earlier panel. And our three questions are the relationship between the church's understanding of religious freedom and the development of international human rights law and practice, how that relationship has changed since Vatican II, if it has, and if so, why, and the critical challenges facing the church's understanding of religious freedom in the international arena in the years ahead. So that should make for a very rich conversation. So they'll each speak about 8 to 10 minutes, and then we will begin to have them engage one another, and all of us engage them with our questions. So thank you very much, and shall we just go in this order, since we're seated that way? Okay, Father Langan.
That's fine. Well, Carol, thank you very much, and it's a pleasure and an honor for me to be addressing this topic here on home turf at Georgetown, which is probably where I've learned most of what I know about human rights, partly through early years of work at the Woodstock Theological Center, which I'll take up in a moment. The issue of religious freedom has become particularly salient in American political life over the last year, and we know that it's become a major priority for the Bishops' Conference, and has received eloquent expositions from Cardinal Wuerl, Cardinal Dolan, various prominent spokesmen for the church. There is, I think, need at this point to indicate that there are really two main ways of understanding religious freedom. One, which I will call the quintessentially Catholic way, which has roots going back to the first millennium. And this is really more a matter of libertas ecclesiastica, the freedom of the church to define and pursue its mission. And religious freedom is thought of in this model as being exercised and articulated within a community which is in principle independent of the state, in some respects prior to it, and with its own life, which is not radically dependent upon the state. And that this has been a matter of contest in Western civilization, at least since the time of the investiture controversy in the 11th century, that the church has nearly always been menaced one way or another by political regimes that thought that the church had too much power, too much influence, a different set of priorities than they preferred. Contemporary secularism is not without interesting historical antecedents. even though they may not have presented themselves in simply secular terms. And this is not simply a matter of the church defending its own turf. In articulating and exemplifying the freedom of the church presented a paradigm for a range of social organizations to come into being that would have their own autonomy, their own moral agenda, and would contribute to the common good. Not least of these institutions is the university, which of course is at home, as John Paul II reminded us of, has its home within, at least in the Western context, within the life of the church itself. But obviously, most universities today are, in a broad sense, secular, whether public or private, and are not dependent on the church. But this is an extremely valuable contribution to the diversity, the vitality of Western civilization. And it's a standing barrier to the development of a totalitarian system. And it creates a kind of frontier zone, a contested zone between the claims of autonomous institutions and the demands and norms of the bureaucratic state. But it seems to me that this should not be interpreted simply along the lines of the great struggles against totalitarianism that marked the 20th century. That this would, in some ways, inflate what are inevitable collisions of institutions and their jurisdictions and aspirations with major efforts to centralize control of social life in one body, whether the state or a militant political party, which were profoundly threatening to the church and a wide range of institutions, but which also became the matrix within which a great deal of particularly international thinking about human rights took shape, with the Universal Declaration being drafted in the aftermath of the struggle against Nazi totalitarianism in the Second World War. So this is one conception of religious freedom, and the other is what I would call the quintessentially Protestant conception, a conception which has also been taken over to a large extent by secular liberalism. And in this case, the primary subject of religious freedom is the individual. The individual who will be acting in accordance with his or her conscience, but and who may well have a role to play within a community, but who is thought of as having a certain sacred quality and possessed of God-given rights, which all social institutions are to respect. Now, in the present state of things, it seems to me there's a kind of, and not least in the way that this matter is presented by the church and its many allies, there's a blending of emphases here. And this, in some ways, may give political leverage, but it may also, I fear, produce intellectual confusion. The church was probably most comfortable with the language of human rights in the period from the adoption of the Universal Declaration in the late 40s to sometime in the 70s. And the teaching of John Paul II, or excuse me, teaching of John the 23rd in Pacem in Terris, which was issued in 1963, and the teaching of Dignitatis Humanae in Vatican II, represented an acceptance by the church of large elements which had previously been regarded as belonging to the Protestant and liberal conception of religious freedom, which now became really part of the Catholic stance on these matters. I'm aware that the contrast I've proposed is in some ways a simplification, but simplifications are inevitable within the time range that we're given. And the purpose of an exercise like this is really to promote discussion and reflection. But I think it's safe to say that since the 70s, the church has become somewhat wary of the language of human rights because the issues have changed. When the struggle was against totalitarian regimes, whether in Germany or in the Soviet Union, there was a certain natural primacy to political rights, to the rights which are affirmed in the not merely in the Universal Declaration, but in the Bill of Rights, in the American Constitution. And it was very natural for the church to feel comfortable with most of the people who were arguing for human rights in areas of the world which had fallen under totalitarian control, or in areas which were under the influence of national security states of the type that developed in the southern cone of Latin America or in the apartheid regime in South Africa. And the church wound up being in fairly comfortable alliance with a broad range of social activists, largely on the left, who probably did not share a lot of the other theological positions of the church. In the American context, the expansion of rights, which particularly focused on the rights of women, was something and which was then in turn specified as involving rights to abortion and reproductive health, was something that was bound to make the church uncomfortable with simply the straightforward affirmation of human rights across the board. And this has led to, I think, a certain, not to the renunciation of the church's commitment to human rights by any means, but to a certain wariness when human rights was presented as a kind of across the board standard or a banner around which people were to rally. So one of the important things to notice about human rights in the last two generations is that the expansive character of this language and the increasingly universalist and absolutist way in which its proponents have applied it to a wide variety of social circumstances. The rigidity in a lot of these arguments is not purely and simply on the side of the church, not by any means. In fact, in many ways, a human rights culture has developed which has a fairly significant anti-clerical tinge. And the way in which, for instance, the child abuse cases were pursued in Belgium with a more than vigorous implementation reminds us that, and that's something which is grafted onto a longstanding anti-clerical split in that culture, reminds us that there can be perhaps I'm being more concise than I realized. Okay, is it possible? we have I think a gradual. Well, as I said earlier, a gradual diminishment of or increased wariness of the church with regard to the invocation of human rights. We also have, as we look forward, areas where, well, let me pick up one point that I just dropped. There is in the human rights culture, I think, a kind of progression from citizen activism, which contrasts with the reliance on working problems out through patrons and clients, which is characteristic of a great deal of Latin culture and of Catholic cultures more broadly, through litigation and through judicial decisions. And partly because of some of the secularizing influences that have been manifest in the legal profession and in some of the caring professions, the church is less comfortable in this environment than it used to be. And in some cases, there's a reluctance to trust these processes. And this has been exacerbated by the difficulties the church has experienced in this country as a consequence of the sexual abuse crisis. if we look forward at some of the problems that need to be faced, One is a much fuller, more honest, more expansive account of the rights of women. And the positions need to be worked out, which the church can live with, which come closer to satisfying the aspirations and legitimate demands of women. This, of course, is also a very significant issue for the Muslim community. And it would be a great mistake for the church to look for support for some of its own imperiled contentions by an alliance with similar tendencies in the Islamic world. Secondly, there are likely to be continued points of tension, not so much in by way of a grand ideological conflict, as just by lots of very practical, nitty-gritty questions about privacy and information policy. The technological base is changing, and the kinds of questions that can be asked, both in the pursuit of legal cases and in efforts to implement various desirable social objectives, are likely to be intrusive and experienced by the church as a threat to the way it governs itself and the way it responds to the needs of people that it serves. There are also likely to be questions about exclusions from public space. Earlier this week, the Deputy Prime Minister in Great Britain referred to people who oppose same-sex marriage simply as bigots. He has since tried to unscramble that particular blunder, but the case that Cardinal Wuerl mentioned about the adoption agencies. There will be pressures within certain ways of thinking about human rights which will marginalize the church and which will intensify that wariness that I mentioned earlier. This happened some years ago with Amnesty International, where the Amnesty decided to include a right to abortion among the rights to be defended. And this was something which was bound to marginalize Catholic participation and commitment. And one of the glories of Amnesty had been its effort to try to keep out of disputes, political disputes and cultural disputes, which were not tied to the basic human rights, which are essential to the protection of society, of free societies. In all this, I think we run many dangers of misdescribing and misunderstanding people on the other side of various controversies. The church in the recent period in this country has shown a penchant for presenting itself as the object of persecution. And that may be an attractive scenario, but I think it involves making a whole series of extremely negative judgments about many of our fellow citizens. We need not be naive in thinking that there is in somehow agreement just around the corner. There can in fact be longstanding hostility, but there is not much to be gained in the long run, I think, by deepening the disagreements.
So. Thank you. Didn't even have to flash the little time card.
Okay.
Thank you. So Father Langan has started us off giving us some issues that will confront the church on human rights grounds in the future. Well, now and in the future. And Dan, take it from there.
Do I get to take some of his time then? Is that me?
No. I think so,
not really,
yes.
Not really, not really.
How is happy to yield to Notre Dame.
I'll remember that. So. How should the Catholic Church respond to a government that threatens its freedom? Over the past year, the Catholic Church in the United States has come to face this question in historically unprecedented ways through the HHS mandate, which itself followed on the heels of other novel curtailments felt by Catholic relief services, Catholic charities, certain Catholic adoption agencies, as well as the Catholic Church in Alabama in relation to its ministry to immigrants. Meanwhile, perhaps coincidentally, perhaps not, American Catholics encountered the same question in the movie theater when early this past summer, the film For Greater Glory portrayed the largely unknown but colossally bloody war between the Cristero Rebellion and the anti-clerical government of Plutarco Calles, just south of the border in Mexico during the 1920s. It was not directly through military victory that the rights of the church were at least partially restored in that conflict, but rather through the diplomacy involving the U.S. ambassador, Vatican diplomats, and the Mexican government. My reflections today bring these two episodes together. Through a historical and global look at the church's response to curtailments of its religious freedom, I'd like to ask what lessons we can learn for the Catholic Church in the United States today. Importantly, this is a question faced not simply by national Catholic churches vis-a-vis their own governments, but is also a diplomatic and transnational question due to the typical involvement of the Vatican. Thus, I engage the question of the panel by looking at Vatican diplomacy. The Church engages in diplomacy from a unique position as the body of Christ, universal in its claims, and bequeathed with a visible hierarchy that spans across the globe. It is challenged by the sovereign state, an entity that has territorial boundaries and whose government holds a monopoly of coercive force within those boundaries. This alone makes conflict virtually inevitable. The Church's efforts to preserve its integrity vis-a-vis states have involved manifold tools, demarches and denunciations, communications and excommunications, alliances, papal bulls, martyrs, and nuncios. It is equally the case that whenever these tools are used, members of the church debate their use, hawks calling for tougher confrontation, doves adapting to realities through diplomacy, just as American Catholics today debate how to respond to the HHS mandate. Despite having achieved establishment status after the conversion of the Emperor Constantine in 313, by the 10th century or so, the church had become a political football, bereft of freedom in the matter most important to its freedom, the appointment of bishops. Thanks to the Gregorian reforms of the 11th century, which Father Langen spoke, the church regained this control, though even in the Middle Ages, its freedom could be threatened, as we know from the murder of Thomas Becket. Drawing on my work with Monica Toft and Tim Shaw in God's Century, I want to argue that the following period of European history, from around 1300 to 1789, is one in which the church weakened more and more in its power and authority relative to the sovereign state, which grew, expanded, and made increasing claims to govern the church during the same centuries. Yet during this same period, at least in Catholic countries, monarchs remained avowedly friendly to the church. They were Christian monarchs, claiming to govern in the church's favor. As a consequence, Vatican diplomacy was often in the position of negotiating with Catholic monarchs, maybe even its own bishops sometimes, over the extent of their authority over the church. One can see this in negotiations over the Gallican liberties that the crown asserted over the church in France, or the patronato royale that the Pope granted to Spanish kings and governors to wield authority over the colonial Latin American church, even while monarchs in both cases sought to establish and promote the church in these realms, sometimes used means of doing that we now find troubling. This period came to an end, and a new period of far greater hostility emerged through the French Revolution, beginning in 1789. Motivated by Enlightenment ideals, the revolutionaries thought that the church would disappear just because of its ideas and so forth, but also sought to hasten its demise. In 1790, the revolutionary government established the civil constitution of the clergy, which put control of the church directly in the hands of the state. Through the 19th and 20th centuries, republican governments in the French Revolution sense of republican followed this model by seeking to control the church's governance, its education of children, its monasteries, and its general role in society. The Caius government of new cinematic fame is an example. The 20th century also saw the rise of regimes that sought even harsher control of the church and even greater ambitions for its demise, especially communist governments and Nazi Germany. How did church diplomacy respond to the harsher threats of this period? Often it sought to engage in diplomatic negotiation with regimes that threatened it, perhaps its key leverage here being the presence of Catholic populations in the countries that these regimes wanted to control. A common device, one that indeed dates back to the early 12th century, was the concordat, an agreement between the church, usually the pope, in the government of a country, usually in some manner of, with some details varying from case to case, the church would grant that government some degree of control over the church in its country in exchange for that government's agreement to protect the remaining privileges. Now, the three most controversial concordats, but hardly the only ones, were with Napoleon, Mussolini, and Hitler. though each leaves us with a bitter aftertaste of collaboration, especially the one with Hitler's government in 1933, his nascent government. Each of them was negotiated by a church who perceived itself in a weak position and sought to protect its authority and its mission in the country in question. The final concordat in church history was signed with the Franco regime in Spain in 1953. During the 19th and early 20th century, the church also sought to strengthen the authority of the papacy and to promote Catholic civil society, eventually giving approval to Christian democratic political parties who would compete electorally in the name of the church's interest. With respect to communist governments, there was far less that the church could do. It engaged little with the Soviet or Eastern European communist governments until after Vatican II, when the church sought, through dialogue, to secure not a modus vivendi, but a modus non moriendi that would secure the existence of the church and some degree of ties with the Vatican, however frail. This until John Paul II, of course, who took a more assertively evangelical approach to defending human rights and religious freedom on the basis of the council's documents in communist Poland. The case of China is also one where the communist government harshly sought to stamp out the church's hierarchy by expelling bishops and forming alternative patriotic churches in the 1950s and 1960s. In the past decade and a half or so, some progress towards conciliation has been made through Vatican diplomacy, including recognizing bishops who had been ordained illicitly. Progress is halting, though, with the Chinese official church illicitly ordaining four more bishops without Vatican approval since 2010. So, are there lessons to be learned from all this history about how the church ought to preserve its freedom? Well, the immense variety of circumstances in which the church finds itself forbids easy maxims. Still, insofar as generalizations are possible, I venture that in the era of the nation state, the church best preserves its freedom to operate, and indeed to be the church, by remaining at an institutional distance from the state in its authority structure, its personal ties, its laws and governance, its finances, and its activities. Now, this might seem obvious to the point of tautology. The church best preserves its freedom by being free. However, many Catholics over the centuries have thought the church is most secure, or most just, or most appealing in some other sense, when it agrees to close supervision from the state, along the lines of the Gallican model in ancient Ancien Regime France, the Anglican model in England, or I dare say, perhaps, the model implied by the HHS mandate. Of course, in many difficult circumstances of oppression, the church simply must do the best it can, and often has little choice but to be closely supervised by the state. But even under authoritarian regimes, the churches that are most successful in opposing that authoritarianism, or being the church in remarkable ways, are the ones that maintain the greatest degree of relative autonomy. To see the point, consider three pairwise comparisons. The Catholic Church in Rwanda, which was cozy with the Hutu government for a generation, proved impotent and even acquiescent when the genocide of 1994 came along. By contrast, the Catholic Church in Uganda, with a tradition of independence, has played a vital and dynamic role in being a promoter of peace and reconciliation in the civil war in that country. Second, during the Cold War, a Catholic Church in Hungary that was closely supervised and monitored by the government provided little opposition, whereas the Catholic Church in Poland, which had clawed vigorously for its independence under its communist regime, was instrumental in bringing down that regime. Finally, in South America during the 1970s and 1980s, the Catholic Church in Chile was dynamic in its opposition to the regime of Augusto Pinochet, while the Catholic Church next door in Argentina, whose hierarchy was closely interlocked with that of the ruling junta, played little oppositional role in that country's dirty wars. We don't live under an authoritarian regime in the United States with respect to religious freedom or any other value. Consonantly, the church's opposition to curtailments of religious freedom has been entirely consonant with democratic participation. Archbishop Dolan meets with President Obama. The bishops make public statements. Universities like mine file lawsuits. Still, the curtailments of, maybe we could talk about Georgetown and Notre Dame again there, but that's a conversation we don't have to have. Still, the curtailments of the church's freedom of the past few years are arguably among the greatest restrictions of its religious freedom in the history of the Republic. I believe that they represent a stride towards management of religion that is more typical of, say, France or Turkey than of the republic in which we've lived. Many Catholics in the U.S. Don't consider these restrictions a threat and recommend acquiescing to them. But history and contemporary global comparisons, in my view, counsel a profound wariness towards state governance of religion, even when this governance comes with a smile. Should we continue further in this direction, the church in America might well have to turn to concordats, mobilizing dissidents, or even prophetic pilgrimages, all the imperfect tools of beleaguered diplomacy.
Dan, thank you very much. And now to a spokesman from another great Catholic university, Catholic University, Bob Destro.
Thank you. Thank you. It's great to be here. And, as the lawyer on the panel, I promise not to be real detailed and give you a hermeneutical exegesis of any of these international human rights norms. What I'd like to do is move us up kind of almost one level of generality and to talk a little bit about the international human rights norms as a structure. You know, like what is it, you know, what is it that they do? And what can we learn by looking at the structures and how they got put together? And, you know, I do this with my beginning constitutional law students when we talk about Federalist 51, you know, where it talks first that we split, you know, the government between federal and state, and then we split it into three more parts. You know, and of course in the state as well, precisely so we would keep them at each other's throats. I mean, the whole idea, you know, behind Federalist 51 and Federalist 10 was that we want them fighting with each other. Because if they're busy fighting with each other, then they will leave us alone. And so what I describe to the students is that the structure of our Constitution, and properly understood, the structure of the international human rights norms is like a geodesic dome. You know, it's not a lattice, it's a dome under which we can find, there are nooks and crannies where we can go hide, and we can go petition for redress of grievances. You know, and this is why you can file a lawsuit. This is why I was one of the kind of the dissenters when people were crying rivers over the Smith decision, because people forget, you know, that religious freedom requires a political consensus. You know, and if we forget that we got to do the hard work of politicking in order to protect ourselves, we're going to find ourselves, guess what, where we're at right now. You know, because we have forgotten, you know, that you have to, that, you know, religious freedom, as they say, isn't free. It takes constant maintenance in order to keep those structures in line. Now, one of the things I wanted to start out with, since we had three questions that we were supposed to deal with, is the first question, which is, what's the relationship between the church's understanding of religious freedom and the development of international human rights law and practice? Now, that's a really big question, you know, but the one thing we can say about it is that dome almost orbits the church. I mean, the church is so integral to our, the Catholic Church experience is so integral to our very Western understanding of religious freedom that we forget, you know, that we forget. Now, some of that was, you know, not a pleasant history. You know, it was, you know, there was a lot of persecution out there. You know, they didn't call Martin Luther and Wesley and others Protestants because they weren't reacting to anything. They were protesting, and they still are. You know, and sometimes rightly so. You know, and so what we have here is, as one writer put it, religious freedom is the foundation, is the cornerstone of human rights. We call it the first freedom not because it's first, you know, because actually it wasn't. Money came first in the Bill of Rights, but they didn't enact that till later. that it's a, as he put it, a cardinal freedom matured from the contextual or interpretations and teachings of Christian scripture and a history of religious intolerance and persecution. You know, so much of our understanding, and this might, to say, well, geez, human rights norms came out of a debate within Christianity about how we operationalize the love God and love your neighbor idea of the Great Commandment. You know, it seems strange today because many human rights activists and human rights organizations, including Amnesty International, now take a look at the they take a look at the church and her teachings and they say, you are anti-human rights. Okay, you are the antithesis. We're still protesting. And we need to keep getting, we need to push you out, in order for ourselves to feel free. Okay, now that, that is a big problem, to say the least. And, and so when you say, what was it that, how did the church influence this early pre-Vatican II understanding is that within the church there has been a constant struggle over two basic elements of doctrine. One is, and it's in Dignitatis Humanae as well, that first, quote, the one true religion subsists in the Catholic and Apostolic Church. And the second one is that every man has the duty to seek the truth in matters religious. And echoes over that struggle, really lie at the foundation of everything we're seeing, not only here, but in Yemen, and in Cairo, and in the Muslim community. And so the idea is, in the West, it's simply assumed that the struggle against the teaching of the church is the crucible in which our concepts of human rights were formed. Okay, so in one respect, it wouldn't look like that unless the Catholic Church had looked the way it looked over history. Now, unfortunately today, as John Paul the Great pointed out in Veritatis Splendor, he says, it's no longer a matter of limited and occasional dissent, but of an overall and systematic calling into question of traditional moral doctrine on the basis of certain anthropological and ethical presuppositions. In other words, you're just wrong. We just are coming at it from a completely different perspective. Now, how's that changed since Vatican II? Well, Dignitatis Humanae and I think equally Nostra Aetate, which spoke first to the Catholic community about its own obligations with respect to religious freedom among Christians. And then Nostra Aetate, how were we supposed to react to non-Christians? Now, both of these documents spoke to Catholics first in a language that Catholics understand. It's a bit like the account of Pentecost, when they say, how is it there were Medes and Parthians, but we can all hear them in our own language? Well, this was written in the language that the Catholics could understand, but it was also accessible to others. And it has given us a common language on which we can have a discourse about what's right and wrong to do. How do we serve God and love our neighbors at the same time? And, but what... And they also, both of these documents form a really good foundation on which we can have an honest-to-goodness dialogue of cultures. Okay? And, and we cannot have that discussion. And believe me, I've got the scars to prove it. If the State Department and USAID get the shivers, if religious believers engage one another on things like things in international law and international human rights, like the status of Jerusalem, a very easy question, right? The morality of possession and use of weapons of mass destruction. I mean, you would not imagine. I mean, I had somebody at the Pentagon tell me, we can't talk to an Ayatollah. Why? Separation of church and state. I said, yeah, but he's the one you got to get the signature of. You know, if you can't talk to him, how are you going to make an agreement? And you better not talk to him in the language of secular liberalism, because he's not even going to hear you. He may be listening, but he's not going to hear you. Okay, now, unfortunately, you know, and this is where I kind of mildly disagree with Father Langan in this point about, you know, making alliances across these gulfs. As another writer pointed out, he says, and I think he's right on this, he says, the sustainability and enforcement of the International Human Rights Project in toto depends on its ideological placement within the particular scriptures, rites, and histories of the world's major religious traditions, namely Hinduism, Buddhism, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. In other words, unless you can locate a human rights paradigm within Islam, you're never going to get there with the Muslim world. They're not going to hear you. You know, talking, as the late Robert Cover said in an amazing talk he gave at Catholic U back in 1987, just before he passed away, he said, the reasons why, he says, in the Jewish tradition, a rights model doesn't make sense, he says, is because Jews don't talk that way. He says, it's mitzvah. It's an incumbent obligation. He says, a right without an, and I'm quoting now, a right without an obligation is a sad, almost a pathetic thing. So he wouldn't talk about a right to, a Jew wouldn't talk about a right to education. He'd talk about the duty of the parents. You know, you don't talk about the right to equal protection. You talk about the right, the obligation that we all have to each other not to pay attention to stupid things like skin color. Okay, so these are the kinds of things where the religious human rights paradigm, that scriptural paradigm, you know, becomes an essential component of the discussion. If you cut it off, you know, and that's where the, you know, Cardinal Wuerl's point is that he says we have to be engaged, okay? And if you cut it off, as some of the groups are trying to do, where they blame, you know, when you look at what happened to Dan Cathy and Chick-fil-A, you know, this is you are now seeing the idea that there's certain religions are politically incorrect, that they're not admissible in polite society. Well, there's not that much difference between that point of view and the Taliban point of view of Tawheed. There's one God and he's Allah, and if you don't buy the program, you know, you're dead. Okay, and yeah, there's certainly a difference in degree, but there's not that much of a difference in kind. And what I would propose to you is that rather than, I think our side is, this is a precursor to the next panel, I think our side is making a profound mistake if we rely on our free exercise jurisprudence and on these freedom concepts. Mm-hmm. We have to start getting back up a level of generality and start talking about the political structures, which we used to call establishments, you know, which said, here are the conditions on which you will participate. You go read the Constitution. Jerry Bradley wrote a phenomenal article that influenced me profoundly a number of years ago about the No Religious Test Clause. Okay? That was there because the government's supposed to take you as it finds you. We're supposed to take Iranians as we find them. We're supposed to take Jews as we find them. If we're not willing to do that, you can be a Jew, but don't act like one. I mean, what they've told Cardinal Wuerl is you can be Catholic, just don't act like one. Don't talk like one. You know, to which Madison and Jefferson would have said, in the words of a Chicago politician, not Barack Obama, who died and left you in charge. So in any event, that's it. Thank you very much for your attention.
I don't know about all of you, but my head has been spinning all day from the breadth of historical allusions and the centuries and the places that we've covered, never mind the topics. But I did hear one of those points of perhaps principal disagreement about the making of alliances or the avoiding of alliances. Mm-hmm. And to even make it more impossible to grapple with, this is just a brainstorming of my own about the ways in which religious freedom is being challenged or questioned around the globe today, on the whole issue of proselytization, on the German ruling on circumcision, the French law on the niqab and the burqa, the meaning of Christian nation, ummah, Jewish state, blasphemy trials, whether in Russia or Pakistan, sacrilege, notions of sacrilege, including notions of desecration that are inadvertent, wherein one might think that burning a damaged Quran is the most respectful thing to do with it rather than a further sacrilege. Crime versus sin, you know? International politics can talk about war crimes. We don't always talk about sins. That's one of the contributions of some religions to our international discourse. Reconciliation, forgiveness, as one of my colleagues reminded me this morning, humility. Again, contributions that religions can make that we don't find everywhere. We had allusions to the work of faith-based organizations and development work versus those issues of proselytization, contraception, condoms, HIV/AIDS, et cetera. And where we were started off with this morning, the cuius regio, eius religio, Westphalian settlement versus the Universal Declaration and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which seem to say, no, the political sovereignty is not our ultimate moral sovereign. One that's coming up all the time right now, freedom of speech versus freedom of religion. And the sectarian conflicts and interreligious conflicts that we see embedded in political and geopolitical conflicts. And religious minorities that seek the protection of abusive regimes, you know, and then get left holding the bag when the abusive regime is thrown out of power. So could we reflect further on what you call raising it to another level of generality? If we think of the church internationally as an ally of religious freedom, what does it mean to be an ally of religious freedom in the face of some of these issues? What kinds of alliances should we be seeking, and which kinds of alliances are traps to the church's mission? I don't know if that takes you anywhere, but I hope it might start us off.
Well, in general, I'm a modest practitioner and a strong proponent of interreligious dialogue. And I think the point made about taking people and groups as they are is extremely important. We don't want to wind up in a position of saying we're universally tolerant. The flavor which will be served in all ice cream stores is vanilla. And deviations from that will be dismissed as morally inferior and politically incorrect. We need to be respectful just of the immense diversity of human beings and the societies that they formed. I was warning against one particular alliance, which I think is seductive for some people in the Catholic Church, which is to say that the likeliest allies for defending a traditional conception of the role of women are Muslims. And I think that's something that will not have a positive effect on the church's position in Western societies and is likely to lead to serious misunderstanding between Christians and Muslims. So that was for a number of reasons that's the one alliance I would particularly warn against. But in general, I think greater dialogue rests on the legal structures that are provided by human rights and a recognition that these structures are inadequate to meet the religious hopes and aspirations of people.
Dan, yeah. You seemed more cautious about alliances. Was I listening to you correctly, or?
Well, my larger point was to look at the institution of the sovereign state historically, mm-hmm. and I think that there's something kind of totalistic by definition about the sovereign state, one holder of authority as sovereign authority in a territory, and so it's very demarcated and so forth. And I think there's something about the sovereign state that should induce caution about its kind of expansive octopus-like tendencies. But I think that, in general, in terms of mounting the church's positions, in the book Justin on Just Peace, which is going to be looked at tomorrow, I you know, very much advocate finding, the church has its views on justice that it roots internally. Once we have that, then we can find resonances and alliances with it when we're in pluralistic settings with other faiths and secular voices and so forth. I think I think there's a pragmatic logic by which that it's an ever-shifting coalitions. We build alliances according to what's at stake. Of course, it can also involve friendship in deeper ways, of course, too. But I think there's a shifting character to it.
Well, Dan, I think your point is very well taken for a couple of reasons. One, of course, was mentioned kind of at the mentioned in terms of the privacy kinds of questions that come up, kind of the all pervasive, you know, we know everything about you, you know, and there's really no place you can run and hide. That's one. But the other is, you know, people forget that various religious traditions, some have separation of church and state, others don't. You know, and people always say in the Muslim tradition there isn't one. Well, the Shia certainly don't believe that. Yeah. And they think that St. Thomas has a lot to offer. You know, and when you look from the perspective of the kinds of things I've been doing, particularly in the Middle East, what we are seeing really, I think Samuel Huntington had it wrong when he said there was a clash of civilizations, and he posed it as the West versus the East. It's not that. It's actually more of a clash of two fundamentalisms. You know, you have a secular fundamentalism in the West, which is what the Pope was trying to talk about, but for bad staff work, at Regensburg. And as one of our Persian friends said, well, at least if you're going to quote a Persian philosopher, you should at least give him a name. You know, but they said their view was the Pope was absolutely right. They said, you are suffering from a secular fundamentalism. We are living under the boot of a religious fundamentalism. You know, you have secularism without faith, and you have reason without, or faith without reason. He says both of them, unless we have an alliance in the middle, they're going to kill us all. Okay, now that is when the Muslim scholars responded, the one word, you know, one word among us, and some other things that have gone on with various and sundry people coming in and talking at the synods, you know. You can do alliances. You can even do alliances on women's rights, you know. But you've got to listen long enough to where it comes from. Because as I see it, even among Muslims, they say, "Well, look, you know, the deeper you dig on this, the Prophet's wife asked him to marry her. She was a businesswoman. She continued in business. She employed him." Right? You know, and it was, he says, if you use the example of the prophet, you can't have these rules. These are tribal, traditional rules that have nothing to do with Islam. Mm-hmm. You know, unless you listen to a Muslim tell you that. If I told a group of Muslims like that, they'd say, what's this wiseacre coming from? You know, but if I listen to them and say, well, look, I can quote, you know, Sheikh so-and-so, you know, then I get the credibility of his aura, you know, and that those are the kinds of alliances I think we really need on everything from environment, you name it, the practical problems that we all share as human beings. There's all kinds of things we can be doing together, you know, and guess what? You might learn something in the process.
Yeah. Well, I guess I'm wondering, but they may not be your questions, whether using the Universal Declaration and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights is a good meeting ground for this question about the future issues of human rights. But let's get some questions from the floor. Once again, there'll be mics circulating, and when the mic comes to you, if you could stand and introduce yourself, that would be great. So I see two hands here, one in the back.
I'm Mona Siddiqui from the University of Edinburgh, the Divinity School, and I'm an associate scholar on the Religious Freedom Project. One comment and one question. The comment is on the Common Word Initiative. I think it's one thing to say we need to make alliances, But we also need to realize that these alliances are the converted speaking to the converted, and they're largely to the academic level, to faith leaders, with absolutely no impact on grassroots level. So they're good in themselves, but they don't really have a huge influence. And the other issue was about, I can't remember the exact words, but somebody said something about speaking to minority religions, or you can be a Jew but don't act like one, or you can be a Muslim but don't act one. And I'm thinking about some of the issues about multiculturalism in the UK, and the failure of multiculturalism as it's perceived is precisely because you leave the Muslim to be the Muslim, you leave the Jew to be the Jew, you leave the Sikh to be the Sikh, and there's no common values which are bringing these people together. So I would say that as well as religious freedom, we have to actually think about its parallel word, which is values. We can't just talk about religious freedom in the abstract. And actually, today, a lot of the issues around religious freedom, which is really about minority religions and the place of minority religions in Western democracies, is really about the failure of multiculturalisms, the failure of them bringing the same values as liberal democracies have. And what does that mean? Does that mean that diversity is inherently a good thing? I don't think it is. And I think we tend to say that because it's the right thing to say. Mm-hmm. But I think diversity is only a good thing when it's negotiated with multiple voices. And there has to be some common agreement about what are the values that might be very contradictory in your particular religion as it stands, but which you are, we should force you, we should demand that you rethink. Otherwise, we'll continue to have forced marriages, we'll continue to have honor killings, we'll continue to have all sorts of abusive practices, all under the name of religious freedom.
Very thoughtful comments, more comments than a question, but as do you... No,
well, okay. I'd like to pick that up. Okay. And I think we're dealing here with actually a number of different problems. One, how to deal with members of minority communities that are profoundly alienated in many respects, both from the community that of their birth and the larger political community. And I think that's an important and urgent problem. But the general problem of how to shape a favorable environment for a wide range of minority communities in many different stages of assimilation, and I think there one looks for a big tent and very broadly enunciated norms, counseling mutual respect and freedom for diversity. I mean, I won't give you the text of John Stuart Mill on this point, but I think one of the most interesting arguments on liberty is the argument from the good of diversity. Not that can be taken in isolation. There's no way to boil this whole problem down to something that can be solved with one value or one slogan or one program or one strategy. I mean, this is really a question of how, coming from our diversity, we learn to live together without resorting to some kind of brutal standardization.
I was going to say, I think when we're trying to find common values among different faiths in a pluralistic setting, there's, I think, broadly two different models. One is what I would call rooted reason, where the members of the faith are taking their commitments that are deeply rooted in their traditions and then trying to find common resonances, versus another model, which I think comes out of a more secular tradition that I would call restricted reason, sometimes argued for as public reason, which says that there's essentially a kind of floor, usually as articulated in secular terms, and peace will only happen when everybody reasons according, you know, on in that language, you know, kind of under that floor. So in other words, peace can only happen when essentially the deeper commitments are set aside, and then we find agreement on a kind of, you know, thin kind of basis. I think the problem with that, I think, is that ultimately really amounts to just another kind of imposition of a kind of secular religion, so to speak, or at least something that's acting like a kind of secular Trump, whereas rooted reason allows the deeply rooted commitments to come together and then seek to find where are the common resonances.
I love both of your questions. I think the comments are very, very well taken. And let me just give you a couple of examples. And again, I'm going to go back to this idea of structure. Mm-hmm. You know, and there's those macro structures, but there's also micro structures. You know, and that's Peter Berger and others have called the mediating structures of society. And you need to be setting those up so that people meet each other in common space. And this is one of those dichotomies that you just can't really make up, but it's real. I mean, there is a case that was decided in Idaho involving a charter school that wanted to teach. It was a great book school. And as you know, charter schools are public schools that are run by private parties. The state it's got standards for what kids are supposed to know about religion and history. So they decided that they were going to use the original of the Bible, the Quran, you know, the Indian scriptures, and they were going to have these kids read them. And of course, the ACLU was completely appalled, went in and sued, and said, that would be sectarian. In the, the idiot district court and Ninth Circuit said, that's right. So you can't teach them. So our kids have a constitutional right to be ignoramuses. Okay? Because we're going to protect them from learning that other people think differently. Okay? And now, on the other end of the extreme is a congressionally mandated program of reaching out to madrasas, where we actually buy and translate Qurans into Pashto and Dari, you know, and teach kids by reading the original of the Quran, because a lot of the fundamentalists, these people don't speak Arabic. And so if you can't read classical Arabic, you can't read the Quran. And some people say you shouldn't even translate it. Mm-hmm. And so our government is funding religious schools in Pakistan. And the parents love it, because all of a sudden the kids know something. What's wrong with this picture? And that was the problem with the great melting pot of the public schools, is that we, for a long time, they were just kind of Protestant schools, and that's why you had Catholic schools. You know, but in the 60s, they decided in order to get along, we need to shove religion completely out of it because somebody might get upset. And my problem is that is exactly what's happening in Yemen. You know, I'm upset about somebody's Facebook page, so I'll go blow somebody away. I mean, how do you, you got to get to that ground level, and academic conversations don't do it. You got to get right down there on the ground in those structures and make things change.
Okay, well, I know we had other hands. This gentleman here. It's coming this way. Great, thank you.
David Novak, University of Toronto, and also a consultant on the Religious Freedom Project. I very much agree with the whole thrust of Robert Destro's presentation, so I kind of hesitate to criticize a certain point. You quoted the late Robert Cover, whose articles, especially two of them, have just been quoted by everybody and what have you in terms of representing the Jewish tradition. But I think that he seriously misrepresented it through no fault of his own. Misrepresented it as follows. I think that rights talk is something which works in terms of dealing across traditional lines. And I say that especially because of the project not here, but certainly should be of interest to the Berkley Center, of a book that I'm working on with a Muslim colleague and a Catholic colleague on natural law and our respective traditions and what they have to say across to each other and to the secular world. The problem with eliminating rights talk, first of all, is you eliminate the most basic component of political discourse in the world. So to say, as Alistair MacIntyre said in one of his less profound moments, that the belief in human rights is the equivalent of the belief in witches and unicorns is something that he should be forgiven for, whether here or in heaven. The fact is that in terms of rights and duties, yes, of course, Judaism talks about mitzvot and chavot, you know, commandments and duties and whatever. But then the question becomes, who are those duties to? Duty is something that you owe to somebody else. Well, of course, a traditional Jew like Kovar would say, these are duties that are owed to God. Does God have a duty to command us duties? Doesn't God have a right to our duties? Now, the point that I'm making is that the problem with rights talk in the West is not rights talk, that it's impoverished because all rights only devolve on the individual. And actually, in our traditions, rights devolve on the individual, on the community, and God as the prime rights holder. And therefore, there is a balance of power between these rights claims that are made across these kind of borders. And I think that this is something certainly that can be discovered in the Christian natural law tradition. And my Muslim colleague tells me that it's also present in Islam. So I think that for purposes of being part of the political discourse in the world, in the Western world, which has become really everybody's discourse, even people not in the Western world learn to talk that language, is not to throw the baby out with the bathwater and to realize that what our religious traditions can do is enrich rights talk so that it doesn't all devolve on an individuals and an ultra-individualism, but rather is understood what Charles Taylor calls group rights. And of course, for our traditions, in belief in a divinely based law, is God as the ultimate rights holder who entitles other rights holders, maybe the community and individuals, to exercise their claims on each other and even on God himself, as Job exercises, for example, his right to complain about God or to God. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I just think this is just a point that should be emphasized. Now, the key is really to challenge people from other traditions to say, is this something we can talk about? And the challenge is really to them, because if they can't talk about it, then there's not going to be any conversation. But there are many people, certainly in the Islamic traditions, because of political problems today, who are very much interested in discovering these aspects of their own tradition, which might have other names, just like natural law in the Jewish tradition is rarely called natural law, but arose by any other name is still arose. So anyway, I would just point that out in terms of attempting to create a kind of even playing field for these points.
Before we have any comments on that, may I have a sense of how many other questions are out there? Okay, so we have at least three, okay. Why don't we hear the three questions and then figure out to which panelists they're addressed so that all the voices are heard. Thank you.
Frank Fletcher. I was educated by the Severian brothers before my university experience. There's a great irony in what you pointed out about the U.S. Government translating Qurans, which seems to be very positive. But there are other examples. For many decades after World War II, the U.S. government engaged in religious broadcasting, for example, into the Soviet Union, other forms as well, news and political information, but had priests talking over the voice of America to the Russian people about religion. And also the Russian Orthodox Church in the United States provided religious texts and Bibles to people in the Soviet Union, and they could only have been delivered with the assistance of our intelligence, diplomatic, and military services.
Right. Exactly.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I know in the back.
Hi, Carrie Devra, God in the Temples of Government, and I've written my notes out. I have 3 points. I'm here today, and let me start off from 2 other influences. One is Ad Week, and the other one was at Capitol Hill, an event with rabbis from around the world, members of parliament, and an imam. So my first point is the freedom of speech is damaged by anonymous freedom of online expression. I heard that, and I think it's very valuable to take on board. The second greater concern came from the AI, artificial intelligence, that the marketing community is pushing. So, for example, is when someone goes online and they type in Sharia, they're going to be flooded with similar thought and not have contrasting thought, which is what dialogue between people brings forward, but it seems to be more of a focus to push towards the artificial intelligence in the mobile world, and I'm concerned by the one-to-one dialogue that's going to be lost and how to relate to each other. The third thing is a little bit of a lesson that we forget to applaud baby steps. The imam spoke honestly and bravely in a room full of rabbis, and one rabbi chastised him publicly, and somebody else said, remember where he came from. So I think we need to all learn to applaud the baby steps. So please comment, whoever.
Okay, in this corner.
Hello, I'm Stephen Kolecki with the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops. It seems to me, I was very intrigued by the discussion of how can we deal with diversity and pluralism in a way that would then cause shared values that can actually support a society's functioning. I find myself struggling with that. And it seems to me that within our Catholic tradition, we've commented about the natural law, which has sort of a resonance in other religious traditions, but that just the belief in a transcendent reality and an objective truth authentically, that people authentically seek through various traditions, it would seem to me that there is a resource there beyond us, knit into human nature, that should give us faith that a society that's very pluralistic and very diverse can work these things out. So we don't need an intolerant sort of secularism to push religion to the margins if the character of that religion is questing after a transcendent truth.
A range of questions on which to respond.
On that last one, John Paul II said something about the character of the human person, that the human person is the kind of being who asks the big questions. You know, where do I come from? Where am I going? What's the meaning of it all? And so forth. And so he thought that was a fundamentally human a posture, orientation. And it seems to me that's... this is something we've been talking a lot about in our religious freedom project. Some even looking at the ways in which psychologists and so how we're hardwired for religion, so to speak. It's a very interesting idea we've been exploring. So in other words, there's something fundamentally religious about the human person, and that's something that can be affirmed before we get to, you know, which religion teaches what and so forth. And that seems to me that's a... I think there's maybe something that can help to unlock dignitatis humanae in a way as well. That why do we defend the human dignity with respect to the search for truth? Well, it's because there is something fundamentally good about religious truth, about that search and about adopting answers that place us in harmony with that truth. So I think that I think you're right. That's something that can be a wonderful basis for common ground.
I'd like to pick up the observations that we made about the effects of the technological revolution that we've lived through in communications. It seems to me that we need to be thinking about the impact of the multiplication of ways in which we communicate with each other and their moral and political implications. And I think we're very early days on this. Some of these matters are brought to the courts, but it would be a mistake to regard court decisions at this period as conclusive of the substantive concerns. I mean, for one thing, just to focus on something which is a matter of personal irritation to me, we need a different set of etiquette rules for how we talk to each other. And I mean, we've all lived through the experience of listening to one side of a phone conversation now conducted in our hearing and in the hearing of everybody in the room. And we don't have effective social sanctions against that. But as a society, we could opt for the unconcealed weapons approach to resolving this. But... I mention that as a comparatively superficial, but not trivial example. And we're going to need to think about the impact of all this on our sense of what it is to hear a word, which is a fundamental religious category. So This is a long-term project that we're moving into, and we may need to re-examine some of our presuppositions, even some of the legal presuppositions. I mean, we have circumstances in which the expression of certain religious views may be very close to the equivalent of shouting fire in a crowded theater. And how we restrain that is something that at least needs to be discussed and thought about, not simply dismissed by the invocation of some form of secular fundamentalism.
Or freedom of speech.
Yes.
Yeah. No, and I like the idea, too, of both the baby steps and the technological piece. Because I think sometimes when we talk about religious liberty, we unduly restrict ourselves to things that mention religion, as opposed to, you know, the right of both physical and kind of associational privacy. You know, when I go into a confession, you know, is it a First Amendment question that there's a privilege, or why does the government have a right to even intrude on that conversation? You know, that's a physical space. The same thing would be true with respect to the artificial intelligence. My question would be, are they manipulating us? You know, or, you know, my concern would be somebody in saying, well, look, you're not getting enough things, so you have to look at all this other stuff too. I mean, that would be a religious freedom problem too. So, I mean, I think that what we need to realize is just like the sociologists say, we're hardwired for religion. So religion kind of shows up in kind of everything we do. And so we have to be kind of vigilant on any one piece of these rights issues. And you know, Dr. Novak is exactly right. And I take that as a friendly amendment. I agree with everything you said, but it's how do you speak to, you know, how do you speak to these issues? Any parent knows you have to have a big bag of tricks, you know, to get the message across. So in any event, I mean, thank you so much for a great panel.
Well, I know I'm left still wrestling with the questions of how the church can be an ally of religious freedom. Our panelists spoke about the church's need for religious freedom in order to carry out its mission. And I'm also left with the question the panelists have raised for us about the tensions between the human rights discourse and the church's ability to live its mission. And I think these are some of the questions I'm taking away from the panel, and I hope you are also. But could you join me in thanking our panelists for their contributions?